he has to get a hold of this. He never came back.
And he just did such a great job there. And we all really wanted to see him again, and we thought that Rock Out the Summer would be such a great time to have him. And he said that he would love to come and share with the church on Sunday morning too. So that's what we're doing this morning. And we'll take just a second to get the stage set for him, and he will bring to y'all whatever God has laid on his heart.
How's everybody doing this morning? Good? All right. I know what some of you are thinking, and I'm going to answer that. No, we're not remodeling the sanctuary. You came in and say, hey, nobody told me that we were redecorating. And I always offer this disclaimer, I am a professional. You can tell by my clothes. And I'm so excited to be here with you all today to brag on our Heavenly Father. And I just want to say, kind of starting out, first, thank you so much for having me in and welcoming me in. You've been so good and so kind to me, and everybody has been so amazing and taken really good care of me, and I appreciate that. One of the things I love about traveling and everything is getting to meet family members. New brothers and sisters in Christ, to see how God is working in your community and in your church, and getting to be a part of that, getting to be a little part of that, and I'm grateful for that. I want to share with you all a story. I find that I just like to share stories, and but I found this in my life that God's story starts before the foundations of the world. We just kind of have in the beginning, and that's kind of for us, that's the beginning. But God's story starts way before that, because God has always been, and his story runs for all eternity. And then we have our story, and our story is just kind of like all over this place. You know, we're just like everywhere. But at some point in time, our story collides with God's story. And at that point in time, our story no longer becomes our story, but it becomes God's story. Because I found this in his word, and I found this in my own life, that it's all about him. It's always been about him, and it always will be about him. And it has absolutely nothing to do with me or with you, but it's... He is the focus. It's his story. And so I simply want to share with you a story about how my story collided with God's story and how it is now his story. But I want to take you back a little bit of time, a few thousand years ago, to the beginning of the story, my story that I wanted to kind of share in testimony and in painting. It all goes together. It actually starts, I can't give you the date or the time, but I can give you a reference. John 14 is where my story starts, in John chapter 14. If you're familiar with the book of John, it's one of my favorite books. Jesus is just hours away from being arrested, betrayed, arrested, facing a ridiculous mockery of a trial. They will then find him guilty for telling the truth, for being the Son of God and being God, and they will beat him and mock him. They'll spit on him. They'll rip the beard, hairs from his beard. They will beat him almost to the inch of his life. And then they'll make him carry his cross, where they will drive nails into his feet, into his hands, and they'll crucify him. And this is John 14, 15, 16, those last few chapters of John cover that time period. And just prior to that, Jesus has assembled his disciples together for one of the last times that they'll be together. And he has prepared them for this moment when he's no longer going to be with them. I think, you know, in hindsight, we kind of, you know, we think we understand the disciples. We sometimes get on to them, like, oh, Peter, you know, I can't believe you didn't have faith during that time. Or Thomas, I can't believe you doubted after spending all that time. But you know what? I found this the truth. If I was in that same position, I would do the same exact thing. You know, and the disciples during their time, I think at times that they understood who Jesus was, but then I think there were times that they were fully confused. And I also think that there was such a physical attachment and friendship and relationship with there. It's like you and I, when we have close friends and we have close family, we think that we're going to have them with us forever. And whether they pass away or whether they move, it's hard losing a friend. And Jesus is talking about leaving. And they're probably like, oh, Jesus, you know, you talk like that, but you're not really going to leave. Because I think they were kind of denying the fact that they weren't going to have him. And so he's preparing them. He's like, guys, it's almost time. I've been preparing for you this moment. I'm going to leave you. And he's explained to them about how he's going to have to die and all these things. And I love how he starts out John chapter 14. He starts out like this. He says, let not your hearts be troubled. He says, don't worry about this. You believe in God, you believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, and I've gone to prepare a room for you. And if I've gone to prepare a room for you, there I will be with you also. He said, I'm coming, you know, I'm gonna be with you forever, and you're going to be with me forever. I've done this. I've taken care of all these things. And I told you that it's true, and you can believe it. And what he's doing there, he's painting this marvelous, intimate, personal picture to his disciples. He's actually talking in some wedding metaphors. In Jesus' culture, what would happen and what would take place is that the groom is the focus of the wedding. Our culture is the opposite. I find it kind of funny because, you know, Jesus is the groom. The church is the bride. And in Jesus' culture, it was the groom that was the focus. And the bride, you know, came along after the fact. In our culture, it's kind of like, you know, I get tickled at weddings. The groom, you know, he's like in a closet somewhere waiting to come out. You know, I think when I got married, I think I was in like the broom closet. I would like look at the mop. How long you been here? Yeah, and it's like, and so the bride, you know, the bride's in the back. Nobody can see her. She's got this most amazing dress. It's got like a train that runs like 5 miles long. It takes 12 people to pack it. When she gets ready to come in, the doors fly open. She's got her own music. I said it's like WWE when the wrestlers come into the ring. It's like they got their own music they play. It's like the doors kick open. Everybody stands up. Everybody turns and they look at the bride. And it's just like, because she's so beautiful. And they follow her down the aisle. And then the groom just kind of comes out and stands there. And I think sometimes, folks, and I find this, I think in our culture we think that way, and we think that the bride is the focus, that the church is the focus, but that's not how it works. Jesus is the head, and we're the body. He is the groom, and we are the bride. He is in charge. He is the focus, and in his culture, the groom is the focus. But here's what happened. When a man and a woman got engaged during Jesus' time, the engagement itself was a legal, binding contract. It was just like the wedding itself. When you were engaged, that was it. The only way that you could get out of an engagement was through a written divorce decree. And what would happen is this. When they would get engaged, the groom would go back to his father's house. And he would build a room on his father's house. He would spare no expense. It would be the finest room that he could build. And it would take just whatever time it would take. And when he completed it, he would come back to get his bride. And he said, I've prepared a place for you. And he would take his bride back to his father's house, and there they would dwell. And what Jesus is saying, look, I went ahead of you to my Father God's house, and I prepared a room for you. I have a place for you in my Father's house, and you and I are going to spend all eternity together. And he's saying, do not let your heart be troubled. Fast forward just a little bit to where Jesus is crucified, and the disciples see that, and they're scattered, and they deny, and they betray, and they doubt, and all these things are happening, and Jesus dies, and they see him, put him in a tomb, they see him die, and they watch him die, and they're heartbroken, and they're so distraught. But on the third day, Jesus rises from the dead. Isn't that amazing? That the story didn't end at the cross? And he appears back to his disciples. And I can imagine how excited they were. Like, Jesus, you're back. And they're probably thinking, like, we're going to have him forever. He's never going to leave us again. He's never going to leave us again. But we find in the book of Acts, he's like, I got to go. He says, I'm not going to leave you orphans. And I've got to go, but when I leave, I'm going to send the Comforter. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will dwell in you. And that amazing word, that dwell, comes from the Old Testament, from the tabernacle where God dwelt with His people. The Holy Spirit will live inside of you. He will pitch a tent with you. And Jesus ascended and He sent the Holy Spirit to, and you read the book of Acts, and it's an amazing, it's the actions of the Holy Spirit. It's not about the disciples and it's not about the beginning of the church, but it's about the work of the Holy Spirit. Fast forward to April 4, 2003. Is there any optometrist here today by chance? Do you have anybody that does optometry? I wear bifocals. I found that I don't wear them enough. I should wear them more. I'm in denial. But I found that book publishers are making their prints smaller and smaller these days. I mean, I don't understand. I find my arms aren't long enough to hold my Bible out there or other books out there to read. And so I find I need bifocals. So I don't mind going to the eye doctor. I think of all the doctors and stuff, it's kind of the least painful of all. The dentist, ain't nobody got time for that, you know. It's just like, you got to drag me in there kicking and screaming. And all the other doctors, but the eye doctor, it's basically painless, except for that one part where you put your head down and they blow the air into it. It's like, hold still, and you're like... It's like, how can you hold still and you know they're going to like take a compressor and they're going to shoot all this air into your eye? But I go to Dr. Greg, he's my optometrist, and we go and we hang out and we talk. And he went to high school with my wife. And I went to see Dr. Greg on April 4th, 2003. And I went through all that process. And then there's the process of dilating the eyes, which nobody, you know, that's kind of that's the worst. They put the drops in your eyes. They tell you to go back in the lobby and wait. You grab a magazine, you begin to read. And as you begin to read, your eyes begin to dilate. And you realize that there's like 700 fluorescent lights. And it's like the sun automatically appears in the lobby. And the book, you know, what you're reading, it's like you're watching a 3D movie without the glasses and everything's real fuzzy. So I go in after having my eyes dilated and I sit down and I have a real, this is because I'm an artist and I'm not a doctor. My medical, you know the little eye thingy that he looks into your eyes with? He began to look in my eyes. And he looked and he looked and he looked and he looked and he kept looking. And I'm thinking, Dr. Greg has never taking this long looking in my eyes. He sets the eye thingy back down on the counter. He opens the book and he begins to look in the book. I'm thinking, dude, if you haven't learned it by now, now's not the time to be studying. And that certificate on the wall shows me that, you know, you've already supposed to have accomplished all this. But I'm also thinking Dr. Greg has never looked in a book before. He picks the eye thingy back up and he looks in the other eye and he begins to look and he keeps looking. He sets it back down and he pushes the chair back. I'm like, Dr. Greg, what's up? He said, there's spots in your eyes. That means absolutely nothing to me. I said, what's up? He's like, well, I don't know. He said, they're not supposed to be there. He begins to ask me the long history of health questions. And I'm like, no, I'm healthy. I feel great. I don't feel, you know, any of these things. There's none of them. No, no, no. Check no in the box. Check no in the box. On down the line. He's like, well, they're not supposed to be there, so I'm going to send you to somebody else. I'm going to send you to a retinal specialist. So that was on a Friday. On a Monday, he sends me to Dr. Carl, who's a retinal specialist, and I've never met Dr. Carl before, but he's a really nice man. I go in, and they inject dye into your system, and they blow your retina up to about this big. It's pretty cool. It looks like Google Maps, if you've ever looked at Google Maps. And sure enough, there's all the veins in the eyes, and there's all these spots all over the retina. And he's like, hey, those spots in your eyes. I'm like, that's what Dr. Greg said. He said, they're not supposed to be there. That's what Dr. Greg said. These guys are good. I'm like, what is it? He's like, I don't know. And I'm like, that's what Dr. Greg said. That's why I'm here. He asked me the same questions. I'm like, I tell you what I told Dr. Greg. No, 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 no. I feel great. I feel fine. None of that stuff. Check no in all the boxes. Not having any trouble with anything. He's like, well, you need to see your doctor. And I'm like, I'm thinking, I don't really have a doctor. I'm not sick. If you're not sick, you don't go to the doctor, right? I'd gone to a doctor about 6 years before that for a physical for work. I had to have a physical, so I picked one out of the phone book and I went and saw. So I'll call her. Her name is Dr. Terry. And I called Dr. Terry and it's like the secretary's like, we have no record, you know, it's like you're not on file. I hadn't been there in so long that they moved my files to the basement. It's like I could hear her over the phone pulling them out. Yeah, here they are. And she blew the dust off of them. It's like in spiders and stuff were all living in there. And she's like, she made me an appointment, and I came in and they did blood work, and then they sent me on my way. I was 37 years old. Never really been to the doctor. I was about 8 years old. I had my tonsils taken out. Other than that, you know, I'm fine, feeling good. About a week later, I get a phone call. I'm a youth pastor at a small church in Western Paducah, and I was on staff there. I was part-time children and youth. If you're in ministry, you'll get that. There's no such thing as part-time anything in ministry. But I was in my office. It was on a Wednesday, and my doctor's office called me, and it was cool. It was Wednesday, you know, and I'm preparing for Wednesday night lesson, because that's what youth pastors do, and I'm working on my lesson. And the doctor's office called and said, you know, we got some crazy test results back, and that's not abnormal. Sometimes they're just off a little bit, and we'd like you to go to a lab, have your blood work redone, and wait there until you hear from me. We just want to make sure everything is okay and that it's not a mistake. And so this is in early afternoon. My wife is a school teacher, and she's gone during the day, and I never contact her. My kids at the time were in elementary school, and so I don't bother my wife at school unless it's an absolute emergency. I'm thinking I'll go in, have the blood work done, I'll be back. And so I tell the church secretary I'm going to go have some blood work done. So I run over to one of the hospitals, to the lab. I go in, I take a book with me because I'm going to read a little bit, and I just hang out there in the office. They do the blood work. I'm sitting there, and the doctor's office calls back, and I answer the phone. I'm like, what's up? Because, like I said, other than taking aspirin and stuff like that, and a lot of people, they can tell you everything about their body, and they can tell, they know all. I can't even tell you the names of my medicines right now, really. I mean, I just don't keep up with that stuff. And so she's like, well, we got your results back, and the test was not wrong. I'm like, well, what's up? She says, well, you have a very elevated white blood cell count. I'm like, okay, what does that even mean? And she says, well, you know, it's high. It's extremely high. I'm like, what's extremely high? She said, well, it's at 200,000. Once again, that means absolutely nothing to me. I said, what's normal? She says, 10,000 is normal. I'm like, that's kind of high, isn't it? And she's like, yeah. I'm like, that's why she's the doctor. And so she says, I'm going to give you an address, and I want you to go there. Don't go anyplace else, but go straight there. And I'm thinking, okay. I write it down. I'm oblivious. I'm telling you, I'm oblivious to anything that's going on. All I'm thinking about is I left my computer on at church, and it's Wednesday night, and I got a lesson that I got to teach, and I got to get back, and it's getting late in the day. I grab the address, I drive across town, I pull into the parking lot, I go in the front door, I have no idea where I'm at. I walk up and I tell the lady at the desk who I am, and she says, yes, sister, they're waiting on you. That should have been a key right there. Because usually you go in, it's like, could you take a seat over there in that corner? We'll get to you eventually. So she gets up, she leaves from the desk. I take a step back from the desk, and I look at the placard on the front of the desk, and it says Purchase Area Cancer Group. And that's when I say, okay, time out on the day. What's going on here? Within a few minutes, I met my oncologist. And he kind of broke it down like this. He says, you have leukemia. He says, we don't know what kind of about that right now. Your blood level, your cell count is so high, your blood is thick like jelly, and we're about you having a heart attack or a stroke or going blind than anything else. He said, so we're going to do a bone marrow biopsy, and we're going to send that off, but here's kind of the deal. It's what's going to happen is today you're going to go home from here, you're going to pack a bag, and you're going to meet me at the hospital and prepare to stay there for months. Can I tell you, when I woke up on that Wednesday morning, on my to-do list was not be diagnosed with leukemia. That wasn't on there. Check lesson, check this, check that, go run this errand, go run that errand. Leukemia was nowhere on that. It was not in my wheelhouse. It was not in my plans. It was not scheduled in my life. And the next thing I know, I was introduced to the bone marrow biopsy, which is the most excruciating thing I've ever had done physically to my body. Because they have to extract the marrow, and they have to go through a flat bone. There's two flat bones in the body, one's in the sternum and one's in the hip. They come in dressed like something off of a high science fiction movie with the face shields and stuff, looking like Darth Vader or something. They hold you down. It hurts so bad. And they did all this, and the doctor's like, he showed it to me. He says, yeah, I said, we got enough. I'm like, you darn right you got enough, because you're not going back in there, dude, unless you kill me first, and then I won't need anything. This all happened in the course of just a few hours. And if you've ever been to the doctor, and if you've ever got news like that, or if you've ever been with a family or a friend that got news like that, it's overload on every possible aspect of your life, emotionally, spiritually, physically, all those things. It's mind-boggling to try to comprehend all that happened in that few short hours. My life had been changed instantly with one phrase: you got leukemia. I told the doctor, I said, well, I need to make some phone calls. He said, you can use my office. And so I went to his office, and I called somebody from church, and I'm like, you probably should get somebody to cover for me, because I'm not going to make it tonight. And I called my mother-in-law, and I said, can you meet me at the house when the kids get off school? I don't want to tell you on the phone. I'll let you know when I get there. And then I called and left a message for my wife and said, hey, I've been to the doctor and got some news, and I'll share all that with you when you come home. And then I hung the phone up, and then for the first time during that day, I was what I thought, I was all alone. And I realized that I wasn't alone at all, because this is what my God said to me, word for word: let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, you believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. And I have gone to prepare a room for you. And if I've gone to prepare a room for you, there I will be also. The very words he spoke to his disciples in John 14 are the very words he spoke to me. We met at the house. My wife and I cried, and we packed a suitcase and we went to the hospital. We pulled into the parking lot and we cried some more. Had no clue of what was going to happen in the days ahead. Didn't know what was going to happen that evening. And for really the first time with my life, there was something that I could not fix on my own. I was a believer in Christ. And I was a follower. I was a minister. But there were still parts of my life that I was still trying to manage and run on my own. And I found myself in a spot that I could not fix this. And I would like to tell you that in the days to come, that I was the model Christian, that yeah, I was full of faith, and I was full of trust, and I was like Joe Super Christian. I was going to hit this thing head on. And there were times, there were snippets when I was like that. But the majority of the time, I was more like a little kindergarten girl curled up in a fetal position, crying like a little baby, because I was uncertain about what was going to happen. And then there was times that I was so mad, and I had the why me. Why does this have to happen to me? Why am I going through this? I'm perfectly fine. And all this is not in my plans. And I was angry, and then I was afraid, and I was strong because I knew I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And all this roller coaster of emotions, and over and over and over again. One minute I was strong, one minute I was weak, one minute I was happy, one minute I was depressed. And I go through all this. Well, the results came back within 24 hours, and the doctor came in and he says, we found out what kind of leukemia you have, and you're going to get to go home soon if we can get your white cell count down. He says, you have chronic myelogenous leukemia. He said, it's a rare form of leukemia that only happens in senior adults. If you're going to get something rare. It's a 1 in 1,000,000 chance that I got it. There's only about 7,000 people in the United States that have CML. Most of them are the age of 60 or over. And what happens is, it's a genetic freak thing that happens in your DNA. The number 9 breaks off and attaches to the number 22, forming the Philadelphia chromosome, which makes my body mass produce white blood cells. It's like the switch that says, hey, you need these blood cells and stop functioning. It's broke forevermore. And my body just mass produces them over and over and over. My blood gets thick like jelly. They never form, they never mature, therefore they're cancerous. I have a greater chance of being struck by lightning or being attacked by a shark than getting CML. So if there's a lightning storm outside, do not stand by me and don't go to the beach with me and swim in the ocean. I'm bad. I got a mutated gene. I'm like X. I tell kids, I'm like, if you watch X-Men, you know, it's about mutants. I said, I'm like X-Men with no superpowers. I can't climb walls or change shapes or control the elements or put blades out of my hands. I just produce bad white blood cells. About 5 years ago in this journey, and they talk about bone marrow transplants and all those things that'll boggle your mind and scare you and depress you and sometimes encourage you and these things. I just wrestled and I struggled and I was going through the things in life that you, the questions that you ask when you find these things out and you live with the disease in your body and God's finally just like, look, stop. It's time that you shut up and you listen to me talk because you've been doing this and this is what I want you to do. Just to stop and listen. He said, it's not about you. It's not about you. But it's all about me. He's the focus. He's the spotlight. And I listened as he spoke the truth to me. And I've come to this realization. At that point in my life, it has absolutely nothing to be. It's about however he can get the glory. And I decided and purposed in my heart that if this is the path that he wants for me, if this is how he chooses to be the glory, that's what I want. And if he chooses to heal me, that's what I want. To him be the glory. And I say this as I look back on life. Having leukemia has been one of the greatest things that has ever happened in my life. Do you get that? I didn't get there overnight. I'm 10 years into this thing. But I think about Job and all the things that happened to Job. And we live in this culture where the message is being preached that, you know, Christians, nothing ever happens to Christians. You're bulletproof and you're never going to get sick and you're never going to have problems and that stuff. And that's not true. Because we live in a fallen world and people get sick and disease happens and all these things happen and they happen to Christians and they happen to the lost. And here's the thing, when it happens to Christians, is how are you and I going to respond to the circumstance? How are you and I going to respond to the situation? Do we really, really, truly believe that God is who he says he is? Do we really, really believe that God is faithful, that he's big enough to handle our problems? In Job, all this stuff happened to Job. And Job says, the Lord giveth and the Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Naked I came to this world. Naked I'm going to leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Because it's not about Job. And it's not about you. And it's not about me. But it's about how God can receive the glory. And that's what I want. I want him to get the glory. And I find this in my life where I'm not defined by my circumstance. I'm not defined by my disease. I'm not defined by my situation. But I am defined by what Jesus Christ did on the cross for me. That's what defines me. It's Christ crucified, giving his life for me. Because 11 years before that, he saved me. And I shared how that all came about last night. Because when I was 26, he prepared a room for me. Life happens. But can I tell you that God is good? When I'm bad, God is good. When I lack faith, God is always faithful. When I lack love and compassion, God is always compassionate and God always loves. When I show no mercy, God is always merciful. And he is big enough to handle anything that you and I can ever handle on this planet. Because I was like, God, I can't handle this. God, this is too big. God, this is too much for me to bear. I can't do it. And he's like, you're absolutely right. You cannot do it. Period. But I can. The little video clip that we watched talked about the distance of the galaxies and how far we are from the sun. Do you realize God spoke every bit of that in existence? There's galaxy after galaxy after galaxy. There's galaxies that we don't even know about out there. And as big and massive as it is, and we think, you know, the exponent on the end of the zeros is like so huge to represent such a far, far, far distance. God holds every bit of that in the palm of his hand, and there's room for more. It gets lost there. That's how big God is. And this guy from Paducah, Kentucky, his problems sometimes I think are the only problems in the world. And they're massive and they're huge, and God's like, if I can carry the weight of the world's sin on my shoulders, I think I can handle your daily life. And I found that to be true. That was in April. I got out of the hospital around May. I was signed up to go to camp. I had six students in my youth group that we had signed up to go to camp with another church in Florida. My goal was to get well enough to take them because they'd never been to camp before. And so I worked hard. It was kind of hard at first because it was like, here's the things that you can't do. I'm like, why don't you give me a list of the things that I can do? Because the list of don't do this, don't. There was one on the list that I milked. It's like, don't mow the yard. Yes! Because it's like, you know, you have a compromised immune system. And if you get cut, you know, and you get infected, it's like I was going to put my hand up under the lawnmower or something. You know, I was just like, hey, doctor says I can't mow the yard. But all these things, I worked hard. My goal was to take these kids to camp in July, and I got there. The most amazing thing happened at camp. On the first night of camp, the band came out, and over in the corner was this massive canvas. And a guy would come out, and he began to paint that night as the worship band played. And the pastor, the band would finish, and the pastor would come out, and he would I just over there in the corner painting. And when he got finished, it was the theme for the day. And he would just walk off the stage, and he did that every night. And I was an art major in college that just didn't make it in that college world at the time. And I hadn't picked up a pencil in 15 years. I sketched nothing. I drew nothing. I used no talents, no gifts or anything for 15 years. And every night I watched this guy come out and paint, and I couldn't take my eyes off of it. There were 1,500 students at this camp. It's the biggest camp I've ever been to. And on the last night during worship, I found myself on my knees on a concrete floor in the middle of 1,500 kids. Coming off just a few weeks ago of a life-changing day that forever changed my life of being diagnosed with leukemia. And I found that on my knees, I was still too elevated, that I needed to get down lower. And I just laid face down on the ground. I was broken and I was scared about what was going to happen. And I was overwhelmed by the presence of God, and I was loved, and it was just all these things were going on, and I remember I said, God, I've never seen anything like that painting before, but if I could do something like that, I would do it for you. If I haven't squandered my gifts, if I haven't wasted my talents, if I haven't done anything, God, if you would just see fit to be merciful, if I could do something like that, I would do it for you. And so I came back home, and I went to the garage. And I started dragging stuff out. I just started buying paints, and I started working on some stuff. And some things worked and some things didn't. And I finally came up with a painting. And I got a friend. His name's Big Dog. His nickname's The Big Dog. He's 6'4" and about 375. And every pore on his body just oozes Jesus. He's the sweetest, best friend I've got. I mean, we text each other every day, and I was like, we're like a couple of kids. But he is so amazing, and he was one of the youth pastors that I went with to camp. And he promotes a lot of concerts and stuff in the area, and in different states he even goes and does those things at a concert ministry. And I called him, I said, Big Dog, I said, you know that guy at camp that painted? And he's like, dude, that dude was awesome. I said, man, I said, that was most amazing. I said, well, I said, I've worked on a painting. And I said, I got this painting and everything. He said, dude, he said, that is so cool. I've got a place for you to do it. And I'm thinking, you know, his youth group is like, mine have had like 10 kids and his had like 75 kids. I'm thinking, you know, like on a Wednesday night at his church, maybe, you know, 35 or 40 of those guys will be there and I'll do it there on a Wednesday night. He said, I've just booked Casting Crowns to the Carson Center in Paducah and you can open for them. I'm like, what? No, how about your youth room on a Wednesday night? And that night when the curtains opened and there was 1,800 people in the center, it was just me and God. And a ministry was born. And the God who was faithful lived up to his faithfulness. And so now he allows me to go and tell his story. All over. I've been to Alaska and I've been on the banks of Lake Kariba in Njili, Zambia. Got to paint little pictures. Never in my wildest dreams when I got that message 10 years ago that I would get to do anything like this. This painting that I want to do for you is simply called Smile. And this is really one of the only paintings that has come out of, this painting has come directly out of my adventure with leukemia, my life with that, and a faithful God. It's based upon Zephaniah 3:17. You know, when you're searching for God in the Scripture, when you go to like the minor prophets, you know, like you're really desperate for a word from God. It's like, man, there's nothing here. I'm going to go back to the Old Testament. Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord your God is mighty to save. He rejoices over you with singing and praise. And so I'd like to share with you in painting kind of the big adventure that I've been on and simply called Smile. Timothy, if you...
If the clouds will always be this gray, if I live my life in shadows, there are days I doubt that I can change. I think I'll always be this way, not who you wanted me to be. But I believe that there must be a hope for this hopeless sinner. This I believe. There's coming a day when my faith shall be made sight. There's coming a day, darkness shattered by the light. There's coming a day, death is swallowed up forever. Tears are wiped away from every face. And my reproach he finally takes away. There's coming a day. I know you're supposed. Yeah.
hurt you. If there's a God who loves you, where is he now? Or maybe there are things you can't see, and all those things are happening to bring a better ending. Someday, somehow, you'll see, you'll see.
Lord your God is mighty to save, and he rejoices over you with singing. The God that created the world and everything, and the God that needs nothing, the God that made you and me, he is so big, and we are not even a blip on the radar. Yet he loves us, and in our sin-filled, rebellious life, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I found this in my travels and talking to believers, And believers in Christ, we just need to hear that God loves us. I find that in my own life. Maybe it's just me, but I just need to be reminded of the fact that God loves me, that He thinks I'm special, that He made me and He created me, and He has this marvelous plan for my life. And the same is true for you. And guys, life happens. And I shared this verse last night. Jesus says this, in this world you will have troubles. It's going to happen. Life happens. We live in a fallen world. And until He comes back or He takes us home, it's always going to be like this. People get sick. People die. There's terrible things that happen in this world. It's a result of sin. The choice of Adam and Eve changed everything. What God made good, we messed it up. And that's the world we live in. But I know for a fact, and I don't know a lot, but I can say this with boldness and confidence, that there is a Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. And He loved you and me so much that rather than to leave us in our selfish, sinful state, He chose to die for you and me, to make a way where we have a right relationship with God again. He didn't have to do that. Can say that with boldness and confidence. And I can say this, that God is faithful and God is true to His promises. And He has provided for me and my family in ways that beyond my brain can comprehend. The day that I went into the hospital, we had no insurance. I had just left one job, and then I was cobbling my insurance policy, and it was over with, and we were trying to get insurance. And all of a sudden, boom, you got a rare, incurable form of cancer. Take that to the insurance agent. They'll run from you like there's no tomorrow. Within 2 days, they accepted us. There was never a day that we didn't go to our house, that there was a bag of groceries on our door. You know, I sometimes think like this, that like, God, I'm in need, so you're just going to like drop a lot of cash, you know, in this package, or you're going to write a check, you know, and you're going to cover it all. But He doesn't work like that. Sometimes He does, but you know what? I've never, toilet paper. My wife and I sat down at the table and bawled over a package of toilet paper that God's people fought enough of us that knew that that was an expensive household item, that we were going through some pretty stuff, that they fought enough to buy us toilet paper. That there was gift cards. And every day we would go to the mailbox. It was this celebration at the mailbox, because when we opened it up, there was a card or a word of encouragement or maybe a check or maybe cash from places and people and states that we had no idea. We didn't know any of these people. My mother-in-law bought me this chest, this wooden chest, little treasure chest for me to put stuff. I got to literally shove stuff down in it and snap the lid, because when you open it, it's like, pfft, it explodes, and it's from prayer list. The sweetest thing, I opened up this card, and it's from a senior adult ladies' Sunday school class somewhere in Texas. I don't know anybody in Texas. And like, we heard about you, and I want you to know that our class is praying for you. You're on our prayer list. It was like that every day. Church, God is good. And God is faithful. And He keeps His promises. But here's the thing, is how do you and I respond when life happens? How do we respond? And also, church, I have no excuse to not serve Him. My situation, my circumstance, my disease, my whatever, is no excuse not to serve. Have none. We were called to go and make disciples. And that's our largest, our biggest priority of all. It tops everything that you and I will do in our life. That is the command from Jesus. Go and make disciples. And we have zero excuse to do that, to not do it. And so we must be faithful to Him and continue to serve Him. We're going to have a time response. And Brother Larry, I'm going to have Brother Larry come up and he'll handle the time of invitation like you all normally do. And I'll let him instruct you. And Jason, if you, I don't know how y'all going to do the music. Y'all can just come. But I'm going to pray while they're kind of, we're just kind of working this out as we go. And it's cool because God knows what's going on. And while they're talking, I just want to encourage you. I just want to encourage believers. I also want to encourage you is this fact that what I do in faith, when you read the book of Acts, their faithfulness. Let's be faithful. Heavenly Daddy, now this is your time. And we praise you and we celebrate you, Lord. And I just pray this morning that whatever needs to be done here, God, that people will be obedient to your calling. And this is your time. And we praise you in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to have a time of invitation now, time of response. And if you are here this morning and the Lord has been dealing with you, been speaking to your heart and mind this morning, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to find closure with the Lord. Make sure you're... proclamation is true and sure this morning. So if you're here this morning and you don't know the Lord, you don't know that you're even saved, you don't even know that you could rightly call yourself a Christ follower, we ask you that you would respond today. I would love to pray with you. If something that Tim has said this morning through his transaction of painting, maybe this has spoke to your heart as well. Maybe you're going through a hard time. Maybe you just need somebody to pray with you this morning and to just reassure you that the Lord, He loves you. He loves you. And that we have hard times we go through in this life. And sometimes it just takes a prayer from a saint to solidify those things and just remind us that the Lord Jesus, He loves us. We just live in a fallen world. I'm going to ask Jason if he'll sing a few lines of Revelation song, and us as a congregation will stand and sing with him. And as we do that, just contemplate the words that you heard this morning. Whether or not you know the Lord Jesus Christ doesn't necessitate you coming to the altar. You can pray right where you're at. But we want to make sure this morning that your proclamation is true and sure that you know the Lord and that you can rest on His love in your life, that He will see you through. So Jason, let's stand and sing with him. Maybe the Lord is working on you this morning. And I'm not one to beg and I'm not one to plead. But one thing I am sure is that the Spirit of the Lord is working this morning. So if you're here and that you know the Lord is working in your heart right now, calling you into Himself, please respond.
I would love to pray with you. You don't, you know, if there's anything written where you got to walk the aisle and come down. But I would love to pray for you before this day is over. And I'm going to ask if we'll sing this one more time through. And let's just be obedient to the Lord this morning.
Praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
I can honestly say I was watching Tim paint and last night too, and I was like, well, if you don't get something out of what you see, then you might want to check your pulse a little bit. What a great weekend it's been in the Lord. As all hearts and minds clear, we have anything that we want to add or anything that needs to be said before we dismiss?
I just want to say, I want to thank Tim for being here, and I want to let you guys know that when we called to ask him to come,